This is probably a little harsh, but I think NATO got lazy. I think the United States got a little lazy. I think we took some things for granted. And we've probably been awakened. And I think President Trump's methodology is to shake things up, make people think, be aware. But my belief is, my sense is, from my experience, is that the United States is as committed to NATO now as we ever have been. So maybe more.
There's no risk of U.S. leaving NATO?
I would say the risk of U.S. leaving NATO is about zero. That's my personal opinion. I think other countries may have a risk of leaving NATO, but I don't think the U.S. is one of them. I hope not. Turkey's been a valued ally in NATO. They're a huge military. They've got fantastic people. Their position is, like Romania, strategically significant. The U.S. is very disturbed by the fact that Turkey is going to buy the S-400 weapon system from Russia. That is counter to everything we believe NATO should do and stand for. So that's problematic. If Turkey continues to push away from NATO and make itself closer to Russia, let's say, or maybe Iran, that's going to be problematic, I think. That's my personal opinion. I'm not speaking for the United States, but that's an issue, and we all need to face it.
What do you think that scenario will be like for Romania, being here on the east?
Well, I think it's going to be even more intense for Romania because of the locale, the Black Sea common interest by Turkey and Romania and others, Russia. The proximity primarily, and the importance Romania will now grow, continue to play in the southeastern flank of NATO and the regional security. So I think Romania has a huge part to play in this going forward. Right now, NATO is still whole. There's discussion about maybe other countries joining NATO. That was a problem for Russia after the Cold War. That was part of the issue. But I think your question is probably the most important strategic question in the region, is what's going to happen with the alliance itself? Is it going to stay aligned as we knew it before? And if it doesn't, then what do we do? And I think countries like Romania and the United States, for that matter, who and all of NATO, needs to be thinking in those terms. What are the consequences of tomorrow not being like we like it? What do you do about it? And I think you have to. We have an obligation to our people, countries, populations, to do everything we can to make their lives secure. So we have to think about that. The ideal thing is to solve the problem diplomatically through discussions, through economic alliances. Deterrence is always better. It's better not to fight. Well, I think Russia's a problem. They definitely are a threat if they wanted to be. There's capability and will are the two issues in military parlance. Russia has a huge nuclear arsenal. They want to be seen as a world player. They have capability. They certainly have regional capability. They've already proved it in Crimea and Ukraine, and who knows. They've got a little bit of a foothold in the Middle East because I think we got lazy out there in the United States and let that happen. Do I think they're a peer? Nuclear-wise, I think they're definitely in the superpower mode. Conventionally, I think probably not, although they're a problem. They could cause big problems. And I think Romania is right at the front of that. You're going to have to be the front line for NATO in that effect. But I think Romania would be a lot more nervous out here if it wasn't for NATO.
But speaking of that, would you think that the U.S. would come towards Romania's aid in a worst-case scenario right now, conventional?
The answer is absolutely yes, unequivocally. It's called Article 5. If Romania is threatened by an outside force, the U.S. will be here. Matter of fact, if you look at what the United States is doing for military equipment here with the Theater High Altitude Area Defense System, THAAD, that is a significant, significant issue. And it's good for Romania, it's good for NATO, it's good for the West. It gives you stature. You're going to be the front lines of missile defense. So I think all the basic right things are being done.
You talk about the THAAD system that's coming here, the Aegis Ashore site,
yes,
while it's doing
and Patriot PAC-3.
But Russia, that's one sore spot for Russia, the Aegis Ashore site. Do you think
that I think Russia needs to realize that those systems are 100% defensive. 100% defensive. If you don't attack, they're, and so basically they're a deterrent. If Russia has a problem with nations like Romania, a recognized, independent, civil nation that has every right to exist and expect security and freedom, then they shouldn't be a bit worried about a defensive system on that soil. That's too bad for Russia. I mean, how do you think we feel about the S-400 going to Turkey? Or S-300s potentially trying to go into Syria, which the Israelis usually take care of. So I don't think Russia has, they have a gripe because it takes away their leverage. The real issue is they're not being threatened, they're being taken away the opportunity to have leverage on nations out here. Too bad. I will say though, the Aegis Ashore, SM-23, the PAC-3 coming and the THAAD are significant improvements. You're gonna have the best air defense capability in all of NATO. The interoperability and capability of our partners, that what that means to the U.S. is that we have common equipment. If we come to, for some terrible reason, we have to come fight here, that we have the capacity to fight together. We have the same type of weaponry. We have interoperable systems. You can use our precision munitions, let's say. We have interoperability on command and control. We have compatible not only systems but procedures. That makes us very capable. It makes it easy if you have to escalate to some point to operate together. So buying systems that don't operate with the U.S., this is selfish now, is not in my interest for countries to do that. You need to buy things that are compatible with our equipment. So things like supply for aviation air assets, resupply. Supply in logistics and military lingo is two things. One, it's sometimes taken for granted, and two is, in combat, it becomes almost the most significant thing. And so people have to continue to articulate the need for a good resupply, a supply chain system, a regional resupply of your capabilities during combat and during peacetime. So common equipment, the ability to have a common supply chain. Your helicopters, for example, that Romania is going to buy. I think it's important to have compatibility with your most important partner, in your case, the U.S., to have systems that work together. When we show up, our systems work together. We can, if we're fighting, we can share a supply chain. Same thing with your naval assets. You know, Romania is going to get some corvettes. One of the corvettes from Holland happens to have a lot of U.S. capability on it, from Boeing, GD, and Raytheon. I think thinking in those terms, when you go forward, your decision makers here in country should start thinking about, okay, if we ever do fight together, what are the benefits of having similar systems, similar weapons, similar capability? We're going to reap the benefit of the United States capability by having it in country. It's almost like a insurance policy on supply chain, if you will. So I think those are the types of things your leadership need to think about in the future. You know, I've said this before when I was at UConn, and I've said it in this meeting here, and I'll say it again. If I were, by good chance, the president or the chief of military, the minister of defense here in Romania, I wouldn't worry about the F-35. Like I told the audience here, there's going to be, in the United States, I think around the world, but the United States, we're going to have around 1,500 plus or minus F-35s. That's a lot. There's going to be 2,400 total. You know, when we first started buying the F-16, the plan was to buy around 700. There, a year and a half ago, they rolled out number 4,000 of the F-16s. It's a prolific aircraft. If we fight, if we have to invoke Article 5, and Romania is part of that, you actually have 1,450 F-35s. It's called the United States, and we're part of Article 5. You don't need to buy those.
So you're saying we're better off getting F-16s?
Well, I'm saying right now, mainly because of cost, that you need other things more important than an F-35. You're going to have F-35s. The issue you need to make sure is your runways accommodate them when we show up. So if I'm thinking in those terms, I'm thinking, hey, why am I part of NATO? We have a common ideology. We have a common goal for democracy. We have a common goal to take care of our people and increase their way of life and their standard of living, to protect them. But we also have a common goal to make sure our military has the best capability it can provide to the Article 5 if we ever have to. Your focus ought to be on some of those other things, whether it be command and control, the right type of naval assets for the Black Sea. That's a great contribution because you have access to it. You don't have to worry about the Montreux Convention. So if I were your government, I'd be focusing on increasing those types of capabilities, other things that can contribute to the fight. You don't need a B-2, you don't need a B-21, you don't need an F-35 right now. You don't need tankers. We'll bring them. I think F-16s is a good choice. It's affordable, and it's got a great supply chain. There's a lot of commonality with the rest of NATO, and the F-35 would bring you problems. It's expensive. It's way expensive to sustain.
In the Black Sea, Russia has a lot of forces. It has missile systems in the Crimea. It has planes, warplanes. It has submarines, naval forces in the Black Sea. How do you think it's evident that Romania could not stand against on its own in the Black Sea if it were to come to in a worst case scenario? What do you think that Romania's in terms of new equipment? What do you think Romania should focus on so that we can hold on until help comes?
Yeah, I think, as I said, I think your naval presence, having a great capability there, the missile defense part is important. I think. Certain types of weapon systems that provide precision against, if Russia were to come here, it would be via sea or air. They're not going to invade via the land, probably. So you want to do things that defend against aircraft. They have fairly capable aircraft. The defensive systems that we're putting here are meant for bigger things, too, but it's also against air-breathing threats. I think they'd have a naval type of activity, so beefing up your naval capability, having it compatible with the U.S. so you can resupply, because the expenditure of weapon systems or interoperability of those ships if we ever have to fight together. So I would focus on the naval and air side of it.
Taxing the cost plus 50% for hosting U.S. troops on foreign soil. Do you think Romania will come to pay this tax?
No, I don't. I don't think there's a chance in hell that it's going to happen. That's rhetoric. That's for public consumption in the U.S. The U.S. isn't going to charge you. If we want to be here, we'll come out here and we'll pay our way. The U.S. normally doesn't charge for our troops to be someplace. We're lucky enough that a sovereign nation will let us be there. That's good enough. And maybe have access to their facilities. We have access to a fairly significant air base in Turkey called Incirlik. That's a good thing.
You mentioned the U.S. base in Turkey. And the fact that you earlier mentioned that the fact that maybe Turkey has a small chance of leaving the alliance, there will be the matter of the nuclear arsenal in Turkey. Could there be a chance in the far future that some of that will be moved?
The U.S. policy on that is we don't admit or deny, right? That's still the policy.